silver fillings is a massive consumer fraud. Now, there's an absolute right to know. Even those that want mercury in their mouth, I've never met anyone that does consciously that wants it there. Mercury's going into people's mouths because the dental industry is hiding the mercury. In fact, only 11% of people say their dentist ever told them that amalgam has mercury. Again, though, the lead culprit is the Food and Drug Administration.
How is the FDA and the dental industry deceiving you about an important metabolic toxin? Hi, this is Dr. Mercola, helping you take control of your health. And today we're joined by Charlie Brown, who is the founder of Consumers for Dental Choice and former Attorney General of West Virginia, I believe. And his organization, Consumers for Dental Choice, has just written a report called Measurably Misleading. So welcome and thank you for joining us. And why don't you expand on the answer to that question?
Thank you, Dr. Mercola, and thank you for continuing to bring attention to the fact that silver fillings is a massive consumer fraud. When consumer frauds occur in medicine and health, we would think the U.S. Food and Drug Administration would step in and help us. But no, the FDA is on the side of the silver fillings folks, the dental industry, who is telling us that amalgam is not mercury. It's silver. In fact, the word amalgam is also quite ambiguous. It can mean a metal with mercury, or it can mean a metal without mercury. So it is no surprise, and the Zogby poll, which we commissioned, proves that Americans are still misled. Fewer than half, more than half don't know, fewer than half know. 57% do not know, of Americans do not know, that amalgam is a mercury filling. They could not name mercury as the main component of amalgam. Now, there's an absolute right to know. Even those that want mercury in their mouth, I've never met anyone that does consciously that wants it there. Mercury's going into people's mouths because the dental industry is hiding the mercury. In fact, only 11% of people say their dentist ever told them that amalgam has mercury. You think about that. The most common dental filling, the dentist isn't anteing up and saying, by the way, I'm putting mercury in your mouth. Again, though, the lead culprit is the Food and Drug Administration, because they are here to protect us. They have promised us that they will stop deceptive practices, false labeling, misleading labeling, any market deception in healthcare they could act against. Instead, on its website, FDA calls amalgam silver fillings. Pretty bad, huh?
It is, but it's not all that bad, because you've been instrumental in catalyzing change in the industry. And when you first started with your organization, I believe, I forget the specific numbers, but it was maybe under 5 or 10% of dentists did not actually use mercury amalgams. And now we have over 50% of the dentists not using amalgam mercury fillings at all. So that's major progress. And, maybe you can give us the latest update on statistics if that number is increasing.
Sure. It has grown dramatically. It was 3%. That's right, Dr. Mercola. We're mercury free. It tripled to 9. It tripled again to 27. Now it is about 50%. Half of American dentists, to their enormous credit, do not use mercury fillings on anyone. We don't think that number is growing now, though. We think the pro-mercury dentists have stabilized because they won't learn anything new, and the profits are so easy, and they are concealing from the patients that amalgam is a mercury filling. The enabler of pro-mercury dentistry, of dental mercury, is the FDA. The FDA says to dentists and says to the manufacturers, you may conceal the mercury from patients. You don't need to tell them. And, of course, therefore, they don't.
Yeah, that's really, really sad.
What we have is – yes.
Go ahead.
But as you say, there's good news in the number of dentists, and there's even better news from the international side.
The game-changing event now is the Minamata Convention on Mercury, because the United States, along with all the countries in the world, every major country and just about every tiny country too, went to the table and over 4 years hammered out an entire treaty on amalgam, whether that would be a thermometer or mercury filling or industrial use, air pollution. All the uses of mercury, major uses, were addressed.
The treaty wasn't on amalgam. The treaty was on mercury, right?
All mercury. If I said amalgam, I'm sorry, sir. The Minamata Treaty on Mercury. And I'm sorry. And the treaty deals with all major sources of mercury pollution. Amalgam, dental mercury, is the number one source of mercury pollution among products in the United States. Number one by far, says the U.S. Geological Survey in a report in 2013. Other product makers of mercury-based products are phasing them out. But the dental industry remains because the FDA gives them the green light. In fact, the FDA says in its rule they want more amalgam to be sold, not less. And that's where we have them. Because the United States government promised that they will reduce amalgam use. They will work, they will have less dental mercury each year under the terms of this treaty, this convention. FDA, who wants more mercury use, puts the United States out of compliance with the promise the U.S. made to the world. And therefore, we are challenging FDA. We have a petition campaign going. We are going to the Secretary of State. After all, the Secretary of State signs treaties for the United States. Go to the Secretary of State, John Kerry, and say, you must insist FDA changes ways. So FDA cannot act alone, cannot be this imperial force in Washington. It is out of compliance with the commitment of the United States of America.
And can you just review with us the specific details of what the Minamata Mercury Treaty looks like with respect to implementation in the United States? And is it essentially banning of all mercury in dentistry by 2020?
It is different from other products. And they don't even use the word ban. They just put deadlines on other products. The amalgam is under a compromise that other people, because of the dental industry's power, there was a compromise, but we won. We won a lot more than they won. Amalgam is in the treaty. Amalgam must be acted on now. The reason that's important is if you say something's going to be banned in 2020, such as the thermometer, and that's there. No one needs to do anything until 2019, and even then they can get a 5-year extension. So these products with an end date are a decade away from finishing. Whereas amalgam, it must start now. The phasing down must start now because the convention, the Mercury Treaty, the Minamata Convention says you have promised to phase it down. So the advantage with amalgam is we get action now. There's a further advantage.
But before you go on,
sure.
What does phasing down look like? Does it mean 0.5% per year, or is there any limits or specifics that mandates a realistic decrease, not some phony one?
Well, it's got to be realistic because it says phasing down. If they're not phasing down, they're not acting. They need an action plan. What a lot of countries are doing now is phasing out. The European Union is making a very serious decision soon on that issue. So is the Philippines. So are several other countries we work with. That is, this opens the door to saying, why do we need amalgam at all? And we are working. This gives a green light to phasing out amalgam in rich and poor countries alike. And that's what we were doing. I was in Abuja, Nigeria, the capital of Nigeria, recently for a whole national conference on addressing amalgam and how Nigeria can convert to 21st century dentistry, mercury-free dentistry. It's step by step. It's going to be that way everywhere. But this authenticates the right direction for amalgam.
So what are the penalties to the United States for failing to comply with this treaty and phasing down mercury? I mean, so what if the mercury doesn't phase down and it stays the same or even goes up? Well, what's going to happen to what are the penalties? How's it enforced?
Yeah. Well, that's a difficulty of any treaty, and particularly any treaty on toxins. It's all moral suasion. But we can build that in the United States. We can build that. We can embarrass the United States of America by saying, if Bangladesh can act against amalgam, why can't the United States do it? That's why we're not going to FDA. FDA has a 10-year, there's no reason to go to FDA directly. We are going at FDA via the State Department. And the State Department has made an international promise. With that international promise, we believe they will act. So all I can say is moral suasion is what got everyone to the table to sign the treaty, and that's how we will enforce it.
So what does your campaign look like to influence the State Department to enforce this, or at least kick the FDA into action?
Our petition campaign. And I'll tell you, those things can work. They worked with the Environmental Protection Agency this year. EPA was deciding whether to mandate every dentist to install anti-pollution equipment, as every dentist should, but only about 10 states require it. EPA had put that whole rule on the shelf and decided not to do anything. Dr. Mercola, you called on people to sign petitions, and thank goodness you did, because 12,000 people like that went in and signed petitions to tell EPA require dentists to buy separators. And EPA did. EPA has sent a required requirement, to the Office of Management and Budget. We have another step. We have to get them to sign on too. But we believe this is going to lead, and our information is pretty clear now, that the United States government is going to require every dentist to install pollution equipment, so amalgam is no longer the number one cause of mercury in our wastewater. That was a petition campaign. We're going to have a lot bigger one, and we're having a lot bigger one with the State Department.
All right. When do you think this campaign will be implemented with the OMB department?
On the separators, OMB has 90 days to decide. The Natural Resources Defense Council and the Mercury Policy Project recently had a meeting at OMB and was told, we can't officially tell you what we're doing, but unofficially we're going to act. I think they were pretty clear. All the implications are they're moving forward, and they wanted help when they published the rule to support and push the thing forward. So I think the inside betting is that the Office of Management and Budget will approve the rule, and we will move forward during 2014 to this mandate.
That's terrific. It's really exciting.
Yes, it is.
Just because you've been diligent in this effort for over a decade, isn't it? That you've been doing this?
Yes, it is more than a decade. And I guess that, as Martin Luther King said, change doesn't come in rolling in on wheels. It requires the constant attention, push and push and push. And we have right now a federal agency who is not just disappointing, but actively, not just disinterested, but actually interested in keeping mercury amalgam in this society. And we need to rise up. We need to make this clear that that's not acceptable. And we have the game-changing event. So we have the opportunity now for FDA to push FDA to get the information out. So when the mother with two children goes to the dentist has got to lay it out. And that's what we're urging people to do now, is to say, look, your dentist needs to tell you about this mercury. And if your dentist isn't telling you about mercury, you've got the wrong dentist.
And why do you think this FDA has this opposition? Is it because it's been penetrated through the revolving door that's so common in other industries, like Monsanto penetrating the federal government and regulatory agencies? I mean, have people from the dental industry or the mercury amalgam profit centers been able to lobby or penetrate certain areas of the FDA?
Oh, absolutely, Dr. Mercola. It's just what you point to. And it's top and bureaucracy. That is, at the top is the revolving door of people coming in for a cup of coffee to pad their resume from outside corporate world, serving a little while, not running the agency, just having the title, and then going back right into the corporate world from the revolving door. That's the one group. At the staff level is a permanent bureaucracy, which is impermeable. That is, they don't listen to anybody. It's a great job. They do what they want. They aren't supervised by the revolving door leadership. And in this case, the FDA bureaucracy is very pro-amalgam. Incredibly, the dental decisions are not made by toxicologists. Mercury is a horrible neurotoxin. It can and does damage the brains of developing children permanently. And yet they have a dentist in charge of this issue, a dentist who likes amalgam. So that's how uninterested in the American people amalgam is. There's also a demographic concern here about information. We find that people that make $50,000 a year or less, the Zogby poll we commissioned, people who make $50,000 or less are three times less likely to learn about the mercury from the dentist than people who make over $50,000 a year. The same differential exists between African Americans and white Americans. It's unacceptable that lower income Americans or minority or any other Americans aren't told. There is a fighting back. By the way, the National Congress of American Indians has called on the Indian Health Service to stop having amalgam on the reservations. People are waking up. People are pushing back against the government, and that's what we got to do. It can work, and it will work.
That's encouraging. It's very encouraging. So what are the recommendations that you would have for our viewers today as to what they can do to facilitate and catalyze this progress that we're making, that has been made, and to help see it to its successful completion?
Sign the petition to the Secretary of State and say to the Secretary of State, you must insist FDA disclose the mercury. You need to change our government policies so the agencies of government that do dental care, like the Veterans Administration, the Defense Department, the Bureau of Prisons, stop putting mercury in the mouths of people you serve. Second is to just day by day to say, look, to friends, don't go to a dentist that uses mercury, and to say to the dentist, what's in that material? And if the dentist equivocates, the dentist doesn't tell, he doesn't level with you, as I say, it's the wrong dentist.
Yeah, so that's another effective strategy, is to vote with your pocketbook. I would believe that very few people watching this are actually putting mercury fillings in their mouth. The challenge, of course, is to remove what's already there. And, when I give lectures, I frequently ask how many people have dentist silver fillings in their mouth, and virtually every hand of the audience rises. So, basically what we're trying to do is get into a scenario where if it's me or someone else asks that question in 50 years, like, virtually no one puts their hand up. Because we have a problem for the next generation. We've got to remove all this mercury, and it is not an easy process, and it's not an inexpensive process. No. It's costly, and it's a challenge. I mean, ultimately, the best solution is prevention, to eat the right diet so you don't get the cavities in the first place. But, we have – even the best of us don't do that, and I'm not necessarily categorizing myself in that state or category, but, many of us have no control over our parents, and our parents didn't know squat about health and gave us the conventional processed foods. And I grew up with probably half of my mouth had silver fillings in it. So, and I imagine many people listening or watching this are in the same setting. So we've got to stop this nonsense. And, we're making good progress. 50% of the dentists don't have it, but we need to eliminate it. There should be no one who ever has to have this stuff removed from them.
And the institutional use is just unacceptable, that every soldier and sailor, pregnant soldiers, are getting mercury fillings. Every prisoner, the government agencies, the Indian reservations, that needs to change now. And the State Department could change it. That's part of our petition.
But doesn't the current policy prohibit dentists from using dental mercuries amalgams in pregnant women? I thought that was part of the that was already established.
No. Unfortunately, Dr. Mercola, I know that's a message you are educating people.
That's like incomprehensible. You know, the EPA can warn pregnant women not to eat high mercury fish like swordfish and tuna, but they, it's okay to have a mercury filling put in. That's just, to me, just, I mean, it's just illogical and irrational.
And that's why we released this report, Measurably Misleading, because we are saying the FDA is so sits in the pocket of the dental industry that the FDA will not and does not want us to know about the mercury and doesn't order it to be told to us. The FDA supports the use of the term silver fillings, a massive consumer fraud. We are going back to the State Department to say you must insist that FDA comply with this Minamata Convention. The convention's the game changer. This is our opportunity to change FDA, because FDA can no longer sit by itself regally out there in the suburbs of Washington and do what it wants, because the United States has promised the world that it is going to start reducing dental amalgam. This has to start somewhere. It can certainly start with consumers, and it has. It can start with the government agencies, and it hasn't. But it must include FDA, and FDA must change what it's doing. And right now, we're going to go with moral suasion. We're going to go with the petition campaign. We're going to go with the grassroots effort, and we'll have more after that.
And how can our viewers get a copy of your report?
Well, it's on our website. I think we can put it in your materials. Maybe we can put it on the screen. But yes, we urge people to read it and get the information, because the Zogby Polling Company is probably the most accurate pollster in America, and
even
they are saying, more
than Gallup poll. Because I mean, I personally haven't heard of them before, so maybe you can enlighten those who are like me are not aware of this polling company as to why they're better.
Well, they're based in Rochester, New York. They've recognized that telephone polling, while obviously very good a generation ago or maybe even 10 or 15 years ago, is not reaching many categories of people, particularly younger people. So Zogby has shifted to an internet polling where people – because you can't poll people on their cell phones. There's some law about that. So they can't reach young people who don't have anything but a cell phone. But they can reach them through the internet. And on the internet, people take more time to answer. And their demographics of reaching young people and other groups that aren't in the traditional phones means they have a more accurate base. They're outstanding at predicting election results. And they have given our message 57% don't know about the mercury. 23% think amalgam is silver, is silver fillings. Of course, they're deceived. 11% Only 1 in 10 is told by their dentist about the mercury, and a strong majority are telling our government to clamp down on the deceptive word silver fillings. That's some of the data that Zogby gathered in this comprehensive poll, Dr. Mercola.
Okay, so take-home message is that we are making progress. More than half the dentists don't use this to begin with, but we've got a lot more progress to make. We've been successful and helped support you and your missions around the world to get this WHO treaty signed. Now it's signed. The issue is being forcing it. We're seeking to use moral persuasion, and the current effort is to have everyone watching this sign this petition to the John Kerry, our Secretary of State, so that he could get the ball rolling at the FDA. Which is a good strategy. So not only you sign it, but have your friends and relatives all put it on your Facebook page.
Yes.
Now, is there a obviously it's good to sign a petition, and we definitely encourage everyone to do it. But if someone wanted to do something more, could they write a personal letter, which typically has a little more weight than a name on a petition? Is there a process for that?
I'm glad you asked, and I should have said that, Dr. Mercola. The answer is yes, they can write a letter. Because the State Department, at our request, has set up a special mailbox, an address that is only for this issue. So everything going into that mailbox is about the amalgam issue and the failure of FDA to act against amalgam. So we have a great opportunity to get our petitions through that mailbox, but also personalized and individualized messages. Yes.
I would think, and I'm certainly not a student of politics or American history, but I would think, just from a casual observation, that it's not likely the State Department gets a lot of mail on issues. I would think. And that we could probably set a major precedent here and kind of overwhelm them with the voice of reason that this has to be enforced. So it'll get noticed. It's not like they're getting complaints like from the FDA or all these other agencies to get like maybe thousands or tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of letters. I mean, the State Department just doesn't get that type of volume. So this will make a difference. They'll notice it.
Yes, it will. And it's part of their duty. Just like our Justice Department is who goes to court for the United States, the State Department goes and represents us around the world. And their role, when they make a promise to the world, and when you sign a treaty, that's the biggest promise you can make. When they've made that promise, they have to make sure that we, the United States, follow it. And there's no exempt agency from that. And that's why I think the heat is coming on FDA. It is the game changer. The Minamata Convention says, FDA, you are causing the United States to violate the promise it made to the world. So where else to go, Dr. Mercola, as you suggested, but to the State Department? Let's send them a message.
All right. Well, I think the message is loud and clear. The marching orders are to sign this petition, and even better, create a letter. Encourage your friends and family to do it. Post on your Facebook page and your Twitter about it. And let's get this message out. We can make a difference. I mean, this is huge. We have a huge opportunity here to really leverage all the hard work that you and your organization has done over the last 4 years to get this treaty signed to begin with. Now we need to enforce it.
No one has done as much as you, Dr. Mercola, to get the message out on mercury dental fillings. And our entire movement thanks you.
I couldn't disagree more with that. I think you probably have been the biggest catalyst. So I appreciate the opportunity to work with you.
Okay, great. Well, it's a great partnership for us. Thank you, sir.
I couldn't agree more. And, you know, you're one of our four Health Liberty partners, the other being the GMO labeling movement with the Organic Consumers Association, yes, and Barbara Fisher, and then Paul Connett with FAN. I guess we're going to meet up pretty soon, too, next month in Washington, D.C. for a meeting.
And those are three outstanding human beings, Ronnie Cummins and Barbara Fisher and Paul Connett. It's an honor to work with all of them.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks for the update. We appreciate everything you're doing and continue to do, and we look forward to a successful implementation of this process.
Okay. Let's do it.